Hello everyone, welcome to Secular Society of MIT's second course zero. So we're well into this business. We already had a wonderful course zero subject one with Dr. Aaron Adair, and now we have here Dr. Larry Ford. So with the Secular Society of MIT, we represent the majority of students actually at MIT who don't identify with any religion, who are atheists, skeptics, agnostics, who are affiliated with the Secular Student Alliance. This course zero is about basically like cosmology and physics, and specifically like religious views. One of the common religious claims is that a God is necessary for the universe to exist, and using both quantum physics and cosmology, Dr. Larry Ford will provide counterarguments. So our speaker, Dr. Larry Ford, is a professor of physics at Tufts University and a member of its Institute of Cosmology. He received his PhD degree from Princeton in 1974, where he worked with John Wheeler. Before joining the Tufts faculty, he held a research position at King's College London, working with Paul Davies. His research interests include theoretical cosmology, general relativity, and quantum theory. He has published numerous research articles as well as a few popular articles. In 2001, he co-authored a Scientific American article entitled Negative Energy, Wormholes, and Warp Drive, which explored the limits imposed by the laws of physics on faster-than-light travel. One of his current interests is in large quantum fluctuations and their implications. Dr. Larry Ford, would you please commence? Please, everyone, welcome Dr. Larry Ford.
Okay, well, thank you, Sohan, for the introduction and the invitation to come speak here. So, as announced, I'm going to be talking about some ideas, a variety of ideas from physics and what they may say about ideas of religion. So first, I'd like to review what are the traditional roles which deities might play, at least in contexts where science like physics might have something to discuss. I would say there are two primary roles. One is as a designer or creator. Namely, almost all religions and societies have creation myths or explanations as how things came to be the way they are. Christianity, Judaism, and all of the other major world religions are no exception on that. But they all have some, at least a designer or a creator, and to some extent, of course, they also have the deity actively involved in maintaining the universe as well on various levels. As we'll see, that's become less necessary as time has gone on. Of course, in 2,000 or 3,000 years ago, it was necessary for Apollo to basically ride in his chariot across the sky every day, so that we'd have sunlight. Now we don't. Gods or gods basically don't have to work quite as hard as they did in those days. But there's another important area which I think almost all religions have, and that is a place where you can appeal for divine intervention. If you get into trouble, you can pray for something. And of course, usually this is, it could be just praying for luck, but often it's praying for something that wouldn't otherwise happen. You would say some kind of a miracle. We'll discuss that in miracles as being things that would suspend the usual laws of operation of the universe in favor of a petitioner. So part we're going to be talking about today is what the present understanding of the physical world through the laws of physics says about either of these, and what is the problem. Of course, I'm going to be giving only probabilistic arguments. I'm not going to be disproving the existence of God in a rigorous sense, in a mathematical sense, but I'm going to give plausibility arguments as how much we need God. And there are, of course, many levels on which we can discuss this. So I'll start at the beginning of physics, and say at the Newtonian and later level of classical physics, which is, of course, is strictly deterministic. So Of course, at MIT, I think almost everybody knows some physics, but I'll still remind you of things you already know. Namely, that classical mechanics is a set of differential equations. When you give the initial conditions, then you can calculate the trajectory for all time for a particle or any other object. And classical electromagnetic theory basically is the same way. If you give the appropriate conditions, then you can calculate what electromagnetic fields will do indefinitely if you have sufficient computing power. And essentially, all that is needed are the initial conditions. So, of course, almost immediately, to some extent, the role of God was reduced, perhaps from having to take care of the propagation, namely pushing the planets in their orbits, to having set up the initial conditions that got things started. So we would say the 19th century deterministic universe would be one where you might imagine as God who flipped the switch and set everything going, but then sits back and doesn't necessarily need to intervene, except maybe when called upon to perform miracles. But one of the features of both classical and quantum physics, which is very important, are the existence of conservation laws and symmetry principles. Many of you know, the three of the most important ones in mechanics are the conservation of energy, and also linear momentum and angular momentum. And these conservation laws really can be understood on a very deep level as just a reflections of symmetry. There's something called Noether's theorem, which links, for example, if you have a system that is fundamentally invariant under translations of time, then in fact you prove that energy is an isolated system, the energy must be conserved. It will not change just from the time translational symmetry. The same thing goes with linear momentum. The system is can be moved from one place in space to another without any change, what we call space translational invariant. That necessarily implies conservation of linear momentum. And angular momentum comes just from rotations. If you can rotate a system without any change, then it has a conserved angular momentum. And as many people, in fact, I think Victor Stenger, one of his books I'll quote in a little more detail a little later, has often pointed out that if we look at the world around us, it essentially looks the way we would expect it to look with the laws of physics acting. In other words, if we look at a world in which these three conservation laws apply, then it's really just what's expected for an isolated system with no external force to it, no external agent acting on it. That then kind of raises the problem: if God or deities are supposed to intervene in the universe, then they apparently have to break some of these laws a little bit. So if God is going to perform a miracle, at least one that involves changing energy, linear momentum, or angular momentum, then that somehow violates these conservation laws. And of course, if you go back in the past, stories of that happening are very common. The parting of the Red Sea, the sun standing still, story, many others in which there are dramatic effects which would violate one or more of these conservation laws. And nobody worried about that in past times. But it's interesting to note that the claims of that sort of effect seem to have gotten a lot less common in modern times. As you may know, in the Catholic Church, saints have to perform miracles. That's part of the job description of a saint. And in a sense, the earlier saints had it fairly easy. They could do all sorts of outlandish things and get in as miracles. Visiting Florence several years ago and seeing on the outside of the guild hall a statue of Saint Eligio, who's the patron saint of blacksmiths, performing one of his miracles. What he did is he chopped the foot off of a horse and then he shod the severed horse on an anvil. That that part's okay. But then, of course, the hard part wasn't shown, where the Satan miraculously reattached the shod hoof to the horse, and then the horse galloped away as though nothing had happened. That kind of miracle is a little harder to get away with nowadays. So, of course, as you may know, almost all modern saints have to perform their miracles through miraculous cures. Living systems, especially humans, behave in extremely complex ways that are very hard to predict. So it no longer is suitable to try to perform a miracle that violates the laws of physics, but you can still get away with trying to perform a miracle that would produce an unexpected cure, because after all, those unexpected cures happen. From time to time, and you can claim credit for it, whether the saint had anything to do with it or not. Okay, so of course, one response that a religious leader might give to my argument against God being violating the conservation laws is that either God can transcend the laws of physics, or is an infinite source of energy, linear momentum, etc. And certainly that's a logical possibility, but I think the problem with that viewpoint is that it essentially preempts any kind of rational inquiry. If you go down that route, then essentially anything that happens in the world can be explained as God's will. And that was fine several hundred years ago to invoke that explanation. There was probably no other explanation. But I would argue that that's essentially a sterile explanation, that it doesn't lead to anything. In fact, it's by avoiding that type of explanation that modern science has been able to make progress. Not by invoking the will of God in the way things work in nature. Okay, but let's go on and talk a little bit about going beyond classical determinism. What happened? If we have a system that maybe cannot be so easily calculated from initial conditions. But of course, that happens on some level even in classical mechanics. As we now know, there are chaotic systems, which, although they're deterministic in the strict sense, they're extremely sensitive to initial conditions. So there's a practical possibility that it's almost impossible to predict what they're going to do. Fortunately for us, the classical systems that we rely on, such as the solar system, are not chaotic. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. If it was a chaotic system, then the Earth would probably have been ejected from the solar system a long time ago. So systems like that are still quite regular. And I probably should say that what I was saying about classical determinism really applies to the bulk of the macroscopic phenomena that we see in the world. Most of those phenomena can be explained, at least on a gross level, by the laws of classical physics. But as we know, classical physics does break down at some point. There is a level at which quantum theory comes in. And the essence of quantum theory is that it brings in uncertainty and fluctuations. And as you perhaps know, the uncertainty principle is a statement that, for example, there are variables that you cannot measure at the same time. The basic example that Heisenberg gave was the position and momentum of an electron. And he wrote down an inequality that says that if you try to localize the electron very much in space, then its position becomes very indeterminate, and vice versa. If you try to measure the momentum very accurately, then the position, where the electron is, becomes indeterminate. And you can think of this as a limit in our ability to measure. It's basically a limit that because these systems are subject to the influence of the measuring device, if you try to measure properties, you change them. So you can't really measure position and momentum that accurately. But it's also, I think, a statement about the nature of small systems. that in fact the nature of electron, it doesn't have a simultaneous position momentum. It's really it really is a wave. Just like a wave can't be, a wave packet can't be localized at precisely. You can't say what the electron is. So of course the one interesting question is, if we have quantum uncertainty and there are things that basically are unknowable, what does this say about the concept of omniscient and omnipotent God? And I think many people have felt that if God is all-knowing and all-powerful, he ought to be able to either make the electron sit still or at least know where it is and know exactly what its momentum is. And that in general is not compatible with quantum theory as we understand it. Although I will give a caveat, there are other approaches to quantum theory which many people have pushed, which are sometimes called hidden variables. The idea of that is that the reason that we think there's uncertainty is that there are some additional variables in nature that we don't know about. And if we knew the values of those variables, then we would know exactly where the electron is and how fast it's going at that moment. And many people, like David Bohm, was one of the advocates of that type of a theory, that quantum uncertainty is a reflection of our limited knowledge. And of course, then a believer in God could perhaps take refuge in that and say that God basically uses the hidden variables. And there's no uncertainty to God because they are the hidden variable. And he would know what their values are. But there is at least some problem with that, and that is we now understand that hidden variable theories are very constrained. The simple versions don't work. I'm not going to get into technical details here, but there's something, if you want to read more about it, there's something called Bell's theorem, which John Bell proved a few decades ago, in which he showed that so-called local versions of the hidden variable theory, where these variables have a particular value at each point in space and time, are essentially ruled out. What Bell did is he said that if you have a local hidden variable theory, then there's an inequality, which we now call Bell's inequality, that has to be satisfied when you do correlated measurements of things like the polarization of photons, as an example. And the experiments were then done by people like Elaine Aspect and others, who then showed that in fact the results of the experiments are not compatible with Bell's theorem of local hidden variable theories. So you can't have that kind of theory. Now there are more complicated theories, the so-called non-local hidden variable theories, but those are very cumbersome and not really. The problem is that they get so complicated they really have no predictive power. So again, this is getting back a little bit to using the will of God as an explanation. At least I wouldn't rule out that maybe someday someone will come up with a good non-local hidden variable theory that would be as successful or more successful than quantum mechanics. But at our current level of understanding, they don't seem to work very well, and they're not they don't seem to have much in the way of predictive power going for them. And I think it's important to emphasize that despite the loss of classical determinism, quantum mechanics is really an extremely precise and successful theory. And it covers all sorts of range of atomic, nuclear phenomena. There are almost all of our electronic devices would not work properly if it wasn't for quantum theory. Semiconductors, various aspects of quantum theory are at work in all of those. So it's an extremely well-confirmed theory by experiment. Okay. Another important theory of physics is thermodynamics. And I think it's worth saying a little bit about that, especially the second law, which is a very important powerful statement that goes a little bit beyond what is contained in just say the classical mechanics, the laws of motion. And we understand the second law, one statement of it is that entropy never decreases for an isolated system. And entropy is a measure of disorder. So of course, if you have a box of gas and you order it in some way, then the molecules will start bouncing around and they'll become more and more disordered or reach a state of equilibrium where the entropy doesn't change, they reach a state of maximal entropy. And of course, the problem is that organized systems need relatively low entropy in order to exist. If we were in a state of maximum entropy, then essentially we'd just be hot gas. Nothing, no chance for order. So things like galaxies, stars, and certainly biological organisms basically require a state of relatively low entropy in order to exist and to function. So this has been used as an argument for God, namely the idea that the reason we have low entropy is that the creator God created the universe in a state of low entropy. So I want to address and criticize this argument. But first let me just quote, this is from Michael Anthony Corey, is of course a religious believer who promotes this idea. And these are a couple of quotations from his book. Who wound up the cosmic clock to begin with? That's of course the design argument. And then he goes even further and says the extreme amount of order that emerged from the Big Bang explosion is itself powerful evidence of a divine creator. Well, let's look at this a little bit more carefully. So, in particular, Victor Senger, who wrote several books, one, God the Failed Hypothesis, basically using the laws of physics to criticize religious reasoning, in chapter 4 of his book, addresses the second law of thermodynamics. And he has a rather interesting reply, and that is that you don't have to be necessarily that low of an entropy state, you just can't be in a maximum entropy state. So as long as the actual entropy of the universe is below, sufficiently below the state of maximum entropy, then it's still possible for processes like living things to occur. And as he points out, the larger the volume of a system, the greater the maximum entropy it has. So in fact, if you have an expanding universe, as he illustrates here, as the universe expands, the maximum possible entropy goes up fairly dramatically. And the actual entropy probably is not going up quite that fast. So there's a boundary in between there where there can be some room for order. So that's one argument to negate the need for a creator to make the entropy small. I'm going to talk about a couple of others. One which I actually personally favor myself, and I'll come back to a little bit, is that the initial entropy of the universe might have been very small, possibly even zero. And this is exactly what you would expect if you have a quantum origin of the universe. If the universe started out in some in a pure quantum state, those in fact are states of zero entropy, completely ordered. So it would be very natural to start with low entropy. And we'll return to that in a few minutes. But there's a third rather interesting possibility. It was first suggested by Ludwig Boltzmann, the founder of kinetic theory. And he said that the present low entropy of the universe might have arisen from a statistical fluctuation. I mean, suppose you had a heat bath that was normally in a high entropy state. It's important to remember that the second law of thermodynamics is a statistical statement. It only says what is most likely to happen. It's not strictly deterministic, not like Newton's second law of motion. In other words, fluctuations can and do occur. So if I were to spill the water on this glass on the floor, that would be increasing the entropy.
But there's a non-zero, a very small but non-zero chance that all of the molecules in the floor would conspire to hit the molecules in the water, cause it to jump back up in the air and go back into the glass. Now that doesn't happen very often, as you might expect. You have to wait a long time for that, to happen. So at first sight, Boltzmann's suggestion seems a little crazy. That you would get a fluctuation so large that it would describe the entire universe. But the thing is, we don't know what the space of possibilities is. And the thing is, we wouldn't be here, if Boltzmann is right, we wouldn't be here if the fluctuation hadn't occurred. So in other words, in Boltzmann's view, there could be a vast set of universes that don't have fluctuations in. They don't have observers. It's only when the observer, when you get a state of low entropy and you get observers, that then there's somebody to ask, why is the entropy so low? You have a selection bias. This is also a point which I'll come back to in a few minutes. Okay, so let's turn and talk a little bit about modern cosmology. Again, this is only going to give a very brief overview, but as I'm sure most of you know, the evidence is that the universe, at least as we know it, the observable universe, originated in a hot Big Bang about 14 billion years ago. It's expanding, and if you just calculate and measure the rate of expansion and trace it backwards, you can get a reasonable estimate to how long it's been going. And then, of course, you can make corrections to that. And the evolution and formation of structure are basically pretty well described by the laws of physics. The dynamics of galaxies and clusters of galaxies are essentially described by the same laws of classical mechanics that describe baseballs or billiard balls. And we also have some pretty good ideas of the very early universe. There's now strong evidence that there was an initial period of very rapid exponential expansion called inflation. And of course, I'm sure at MIT, I'm sure you're familiar with that, the name that's associated with that, which is Alan Guth, professor here. He's not the only person to have suggested that. He's the first person. He gave the name inflation, and he first pointed out the advantages of it. There are a few other people before him who had talked about exponential expansion, but had not, I think, done so in nearly as convincing a way as Alan did. And I should say a little bit about what is this evidence. Well, it comes from several things, partly from large-scale structure, because the inflationary cosmology provides a way to form essentially the initial seeds. The initial seeds that are going to form galaxies and clusters of galaxies came from quantum fluctuations in the early universe. And there's a well-defined theory for that. And that seems to be compatible with observation. And especially there is what's called the cosmic microwave background radiation, which was observed in the 1960s. It's now at about 3 degrees Kelvin, but it essentially is the remnants of the Big Bang. It's the radiation which is now cooled down to a very low temperature, but if you trace back close to 14 billion years, it would have been an extremely high temperature. There are imprints on that left from these fluctuations, which have been measured by things like the Planck satellite and other earlier experiments, and which agree fairly well with the theory. So we have there's fairly detailed agreement with the nature of the fluctuations in that and what we expect. So we feel at least on some level we have a pretty good idea of the evolution of the universe from a certain point onward. This is, of course, is still not answering the deep question of the origin. But there's another issue about inflation, and that is that once it gets started, there's a very strong argument that it won't stop. And there's a very easy way to see this. Inflation has to last for a fairly long time in order to solve the, in order to provide the universe is as smooth as we see, and as flat as we see. Which means that whatever stopped inflation has to act fairly slowly. So there's a there's some mechanism that, which causes it to act slowly. And at least in our observable part of the universe, it did act, so inflation had to stop, so that stars and galaxies could form. But the total volume of the universe that's still inflating is actually very, very large, because there are other regions, because this mechanism can't be that efficient, there are many other regions which it doesn't happen, and they keep exponentially increasing their volume. So that essentially says that if you take a look at a constant time, our observable universe is likely to be just a very small piece of a much larger object, which now people call the multiverse. That's the idea is that there probably are many causally disconnected regions which might be like ours or might be rather different from ours, but at least have stopped inflating, but they're very numerous. So this vastly increases the size of what we think exists. That has some important consequences. That comes back to the selection bias that I talked about a moment ago. People like Brandon Carter gave this the anthropic principle, which basically says that we have to observe ourselves to be in a region which is compatible with the existence of observers. We ask, why aren't we inside? Why don't we find ourselves inside a star? Well, inside of a star, the structures capable of asking that question probably can't form. So that's the basic answer. We have that if you have a very, very large region, very large set of possibilities, only certain places are going to be compatible with observers arising. So if we ask why are we in such a region, it's just the selection bias for that. So basically, if the range of possibilities is large enough, essentially anything that can happen does happen someplace. And that applies, of course, both to our observable universe, which is already very big. It applies even more strongly to the multiverse, which is much, much larger. And essentially, this viewpoint eliminates the need for a designer God who fine-tunes the universe for humans. That's often a favorite religious argument, is that if things were different, we wouldn't be here. But then that misses the point. Things probably are different in much of the multiverse, but there's nobody there to ask why the way they are. Okay, now let's come toward the hardest, probably the most difficult problem, which is still essentially unsolved. I mean, what is the origin of the universe? Inflation doesn't answer that, because there had to have been something that gave rise to the inflationary expanding universe. And of course, this is often the place where religious believers take refuge at the issue of the origin of the universe. And also they would also argue that God would have to be an enormous source of energy in order to create the universe. I mean, as you may know, the idea of Big Bang cosmology was actually very appealing to many religious believers. And in fact, in the 1950s, the Pope at that time, Pope Pius XII, actually came out and issued a statement in favor of Big Bang cosmology, which actually was a fairly bold thing to do at that time. Because at that point, the steady state theory and the Big Bang theory were competing with one another. The Pope felt that the Big Bang Theory looked more like creation than the steady-state theory. And it, as it turned out, he bet right. The discovery of the microwave radiation a few years later ruled out the steady-state theory. But the question now is, do we really need a God? And in particular, what about this idea that the energy of the universe is extremely large? Couldn't have come from any place except a God. And I think you can argue against that, because in fact, if the universe is closed, namely it has a finite, we live in a bubble of finite volume, which has at least a critical density of matter in it, then that actually has an energy which is zero. And the formal way of defining the energy is actually strictly zero. And you can understand where that comes from. It's just all the positive energy of matter is compensated by the negative gravitational binding energy. So like you form a star, the mass of the star is a little bit less than the mass of everything you put into it, because there's some negative gravitational binding energy. And you have to put energy into it to pull it apart. And if you have enough binding energy, they can actually cancel one another, which is what happens closed universe. Now, of course, one question we should ask is our universe closed? Well, we don't know that, but the evidence suggests that it's very close to it. It's very close to the boundary between a closed and an open universe would want to be one that has positive energy, has less than the critical density of matter in it. The evidence right now is we're right on the boundary, very, very close to being closed. And that's essentially what inflationary models predict, something that is right on that boundary. And if the universe were to arise from quantum creation, some kind of a quantum event, then it would be very likely to be closed. Because in some sense, something of zero net energy can pop out of a fluctuation relatively easily. Did that actually happen? Well, we don't know. The problem is this requires us to have a deeper theory, theory of quantum gravity that we don't have yet. But there have been some models that have been proposed, one by Harlan Hawking and a slightly different one by my colleague at Tufts, Alex Belenkin, which are different in technical details, but basically the for example, Alex Belenkin's model treats the universe as a quantum tunneling event, tunneling from some state without classical space and time into a. So you can think of it as being a little bit like bubble nucleation in a fluid. Now, the details of what it nucleates in, if anything, are not at all clear. So I don't want to push the quantum creation of the universe too hard, because that, unlike the things I've talked about earlier in this talk that are mostly well-established physics or at least have some empirical support, this doesn't yet. But it's not impossible that it will. And there are certainly ways that you could perhaps try to test this. Some people argue you could never test this because we only have one universe. But I think that's not quite right. There are things you could look for in the universe that might be signs of that, like correlations. Perhaps if you had a sufficiently detailed theory of the quantum origin, then it might tell us a little bit more about what we would expect to be inside of a quantum created universe when we look for those features. We don't have that yet. But quantum creation of the universe has some appeal because it doesn't require a source of energy, since the closed universe has strictly zero energy. And it also explains the low entropy for the universe. In fact, the quantum created universe would have strictly zero entropy when it started. It would start out in pure quantum state. So that would be great, very nice. Okay, well, I think now I'm going to just summarize and then we can start open things up for discussion. So just to go through quickly the main ideas of what I've talked about. that the known laws of physics seem to give a very accurate description of events in the physical world, both of the classical and quantum level. And it doesn't seem to leave much room for divine intervention as to miracles or for divinity to change things. And the natural origin for the universe, if it were quantum mechanical, wouldn't require a large energy and would explain the relatively low entropy of the universe. And I think we can argue that the universe as we see around us, that is satisfying the laws of physics, the conservation laws, looks very much as we'd expect from natural processes without any need for supernatural explanations. So I think on that point I'll pause and we can have discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Ford. I will, we just have like people raising hands and I'll take questions. If I can just start with one question.
Sure.
I don't know if you've heard of this show, The Atheist Experience, but one of the common counterarguments to this claim that you can't have something from nothing, and they ask like, well, can you show us a nothing, you know, to validate this claim? Like, do we have nothing anywhere? So what do you think of that argument?
Okay, the problem is what do we count as nothing? But we certainly have things which are relatively immaterial. So from the point of view of Newton, electromagnetic waves seem to be nothing. We can't see them, hear them, or taste them, yet they're there. At least radio, where we can see visible light, but we can't see radio waves. I think we're so used to them, we wouldn't call them nothing because we know how to detect them. But somebody at an earlier time, that would see if you tried to convince them that there are radio waves going through the body, they would see that they would find that very hard to believe, or that there are the modern physics argues that the universe is filled with neutrinos, particles that very, very weakly interact. And the number of neutrinos that go through each of our bodies every second is a vast number, even though we don't feel them. So is that nothing or not? Well, it isn't really, because we can't detect them with great difficulty, but we can. There are neutrino detectors and experiments that do detect them. Well, you go even a little further in basically quantum theory, the quantum theory of fields, or quantum theory of radiation, we have a so-called vacuum state, which is the state of no particles, but yet it has a lot of structure in it, and the fluctuations in that state actually do have physical effects. So you could ask, is that really nothing or not? See, this would be a quantum state with no photons in it. Real particles, but yet it has effects. So that's the kind of thing. When we talk about quantum creation of the universe, I tend to avoid the use of the word from nothing, because I don't really know quite what that means. I think if we're going to have a quantum theory of the origin of the universe, we would have to flesh out, and then after we had that, we could describe what it's from.
And say, given that, correct me if I'm wrong, but physicists say that the time began with the Big Bang. Like, you couldn't have time before the Big Bang. So technically, you didn't have any time when there was nothing, right? There was no universe, basically.
Well,
in our timeline, let's say.
Yeah, at least in the classical relativity, the time begins at the Big Bang. There's certainly in general relativity, time and space and matter get mixed together in a way that doesn't happen in Newtonian physics. But to what extent we would say time began with the Big Bang is a little hard to answer that until we have a theory of it. And there's certainly if you look at the physics journal, you will see our articles on discussing pre-Big Bang events. So of course they do, perhaps may invoke a time. for that to describe those events.
We'd like to open to the floor for questions.
Continuing on that, dark energy and dark matter.
Yeah.
Can we detect those?
Well, that's a good. Okay, so those are two distinct things. In some sense, we have detected them indirectly. So dark matter is the stuff that is clustered in galaxies and clusters of galaxies. Of course, the way we detect it is through its gravitational effect, what are called rotation curves. If you look at a large galaxy like the Milky Way, and you move out, and you look at the orbits of the stars, Kepler's laws basically give you a way of calculating the total mass that's inside that orbit. And the remarkable thing, as you move further and further out, you find more and more mass enclosed in the orbits of the outermost stars without enough stars there to account for it. That's what astronomers call the mass-to-light ratio. There isn't enough luminous matter, but there must be something there that is causing the gravitational attraction. And what it is, we don't know. The favorite theory is that it may be some kind of a light particle that is clustered, but rather weakly in galaxies or clusters of galaxies. And there's a lot of work going on to try to detect dark matter particles, and it hasn't happened yet. Hope that it will be. Dark energy is a little different. It's what's causing the current acceleration of the universe. That is, the universe, of course, this is distinct from inflation that occurred in the very early universe. We now know from supernova data that the rate of expansion of the universe is increasing, which is exactly the opposite of what had been believed. If the universe is made up of just matter and radiation, then it should act as a brake on the expansion. And it was thought for a long time that the rate of expansion would just be slowing down due to the matter, the gravitational effect. We now know that it's accelerating, and that it probably hasn't been accelerating in terms of the history of the universe for such a long time. It's relatively recent. Recent, of course, means a few billions of years, but not throughout earlier in the history of the universe. It was not accelerating. That can be explained in terms of something called the cosmological constant, with a term that Einstein created and put in these equations, where it's something that represents positive energy density but negative pressure. And one of the special features of general relativity is that pressure has weight. So in fact, the negative pressure actually can outweigh the positive energy density and cause the universe to expand. So one simple explanation for the dark energy is that it's just a cosmological constant term. Or it could be some matter field that looks, whose energy and pressure look like a cosmological constant term. That we don't know yet. That's still an unanswered question.
Next question? Yes.
Thanks for your talk. I might have missed this in the beginning, but I was wondering if you could talk about your journey to your current beliefs, and if you ever did think that a God was plausible, what were some of the things that turned you away originally?
Okay, you mean my personal history. Yeah, so I grew up in a Christian family, so of course I was exposed to Christian religion from a relatively early age. Of course, as a young child, you tend to believe what your elders tell you is true. So there certainly was a time that I believed in all of the Christian miracles or so. I think probably when I was about 13 or 14 is when I got old enough to start thinking a little bit more. Wondering about whether these could all be true or not, especially because the brand of Christianity I was exposed to was fairly fundamentalist. The creation of the universe 6,000 years ago style. So it didn't take me too long after I started reading and thinking to realize that couldn't be right, that the earth is more than 6,000 years old. You can't rely on biblical chronology to to answer that kind of question. Things like geology are much better, much more reliable guide than that. So I would say that was the kind of question I started with first. Perhaps physics questions came a little later.
Yes?
Yeah. May I make a comment about your question and then ask you a question? Is that okay? So you mentioned the criticism that something cannot come from nothing. But I think physics is like a perfect description of that we experience. For example, if you and another person are in the middle of a skating ring, then you're both motionless, right? So that's zero kinetic energy, and if you push each other, then suddenly there is motion and there's kinetic energy. So I would consider that an example of something which would be motion coming from nothing, meaning there not being any other prime mover, for example.
Yeah,
I don't know if that helps.
So the definition of nothing comes in.
Say, of course, again, it gets back to what you mean by nothing. Of course, we understand where in that case of the skating rink, of course, the linear momentum doesn't change. The linear momentum of the system is still zero. It's just the two people having equal opposite momentum. The energy does increase, but that came from mechanical energy in their muscles someplace. But it wasn't mechanical energy before they pushed each other.
So I mean, I guess you could see it from the perspective of just one person, and you could ask, okay, how did I start moving, and forget that there had been someone else on the other side.
Right.
My question to you was, I don't know if you're familiar with the Wheeler-DeWitt equation. It's a description. Before I understand a complete description, right, of the state of the universe.
I wouldn't say complete.
There's a description, but it doesn't have a time parameter in it.
Not explicitly.
Not explicitly, and it has led to certain ideas that we being inside the universe, we experience time, and time itself is an emergent property, but if you were to see the universe from the outside, there is not necessarily time in it. And you could, you know, I guess maybe begs the question, right? Could there be some intelligent being on that outside, which is outside time?
Okay, well, let me say this a little bit about this, since you mentioned the Wheeler-DeWitt equation. What it is it's a way of describing a simple universe by a wave function, quantum mechanical way. It's simplified because it only describes the scale factor, which if you have a closed universe, it's the radius of the universe is the parameter that appears in there. And it's true, you don't explicitly have time. What you have is the scale factor, the radius of the universe, as the parameter. So when the universe starts to, in the Wheeler-DeWitt equation, when you make the transition from a quantum universe to a classical universe, that essentially the scale factor plays the role of the time. When the universe starts getting bigger, the scale factor is growing, and you can think of it as being a clock that keeps track of time. But you're right, you don't need any other time in the theory. But it is a fairly simplified theory because it doesn't describe other variables. It doesn't describe perturbations in the universe. It's just the overall scale factor in the universe. It's very much like the description of a quantum particle in potential wealth, except instead you replace the coordinate, the spatial coordinate by the scale factor. But otherwise, mathematically, it's a very similar description.
Yes?
Question. So it looks like most of the religious arguments against or for the existence of God are mostly just arguments from ignorance, basically. You know, they point to some area of physics that you don't currently have an explanation for, like, you know, what could be the first cause or something. So I was kind of wondering, like, is it possible, has it ever been a case where you could infer a positive existence of something like a God from sort of negative evidence? Like, it seems like, you know, for physics, you know, you can infer things that, that exist that haven't been observed yet, like, you know, the Higgs boson, there's a lot of theory and theoretical math and stuff that proof that led people to think that it exists, even though we've never seen it. What would you sort of speculate? How would it, say, a theologian, like, what would the argument look like, proving the existence of God,
well,
using, I don't know, math or something?
Well, there are, certainly theologians do have convoluted arguments about trying to argue in favor of God. Design argument, of course, is one of them, that you need a designer. There are other various other arguments. Of course, I don't find them convincing myself, but there have been many arguments that have been created over the age in favor of God, and of course, counter arguments as well. I mean, the probably the simplest argument is the ontological argument of St. Anselm, who basically said that God is the greater being, God is the being no greater than which can exist. But of course, the problem with that, that requires you to take, imagine you can take all of the things that exist and have some parameter we call greatness and line them up in order and then walk down the line until you get to the end of the line, and then by definition that would be God. Of course, there are other flaws in this ontological argument as well. Whether it has anything to do with the God of religion, traditional religion or not, is not at all clear to me. Okay. That type of argument has been made over the ages.
Yes?
Just maybe to follow up on this question, you talk about the God of the gaps.
Yeah, that's essential.
Yeah. So for someone who believes in science and also God, most of those arguments aren't really a big deal. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if you could speak to the deep philosophical questions that are addressed by religion, that, you know, can science speak to those?
Okay, well, I'm essentially addressing theistic arguments that require God to keep the physical universe going. If people have their own personal feeling, religious feelings, I'm not going to argue with that. I'm not sure that those are objective arguments for God, but people can, if people feel that there's some order in the universe that they appreciate, that's their business. I'm not going to. In some sense, I would say a subjective God, not something that I can argue for or against.
The comment to the question of proofs for God, there's a Boston organization called the Disprove Atheism Society, who has for the last 20 years been one by one taking the proofs for God and disproving them one seminar at a time. You can look them up. Their archives will refute what you want to refute.
I'm a member of that group. We've gone through many of these arguments for God and looked for the flaws in them, or the look for the contradictions in them. So there are different arguments. There are the kinds of arguments I gave today. So I've presented some of these arguments, for example, in earlier talks to that group. These are empirical arguments. About disproving certain kinds of gods, creator or intermediate type of God. And then, of course, there are other arguments that look at expansive claims that God is omniscient, omnipotent, and omnibenevolent. Then you seem to run into contradictions. You know, why does he allow evil? Or could God make a stone so heavy that he can't lift it? That type of contradictions that come up when you make the concept of God too strong. Yeah.
So, it seems like you're assuming that if God did create the universe, it wouldn't be physically describable. Could you speak to that?
No, I wouldn't say that. I would say just the opposite. I'm basically not trying to use these arguments to say God could not have created the universe. I'm just saying I don't see positive evidence that the universe was created by God. That's a different statement.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Another question related to that, what would positive evidence, what would you expect that to look like?
Certainly, if miracles occurred, involved the suspension of the laws of physics, that would be evidence of something outside the laws of physics.
But then again, couldn't it be that we just happen to be in assuming the multiverse theory is true, couldn't we be in one of the universes where some statistically unlikely thing that looks miraculous just happened?
Yeah, that's certainly true too. So it's difficult for me to say I haven't seen anything that I would consider to be positive evidence, strong positive evidence for God in the physical world. So the question for
that. Just a follow up to that question. What would you consider as a miracle?
Well, I would say I would consider miracles things that involve suspensions of the usual laws of physics or science. Now, so for example, a miraculous cure of somebody who normally would be expected to die is an improbable event, but it happens. So people whom doctors think are going to die sometimes do recover. So that's probably shouldn't be regarded as a miracle, because if you have enough sample of sick patients, that will happen. On the other hand, the sun standing still for a long enough time might be considered to be a miracle. The Old Testament stories of miracles, you might consider. Or say the Legio were to come back and really, really shoe a horse the way he was alleged to. I would have to admit that is a miracle. Yeah.
So in the multiverse theory, would it be plausible for some universes for there to exist a God in some universes but not in others?
It's certainly possible. It's a logical possibility. How we would know which one we're in. Yeah, I guess it would have to be whether what the God does. I think as far as I understand, the Mormon religion has something a little like that. Mm-hmm. Mormons aspire to, if they're a good Mormon in this life, they aspire to become something more than that in the future and get a little domain somewhere to.
Would it be possible for there to be a God in all, a God over ruling over all of the multiverses?
These are all logical possibilities, but I don't see how to use it as an explanation that's fruitful. I think that's my main criticism. It's not, it doesn't seem to be a fruitful explanation of anything.
Yeah.
Okay. If there are no further questions, then thank you, Dr. Ford. Just a few quick announcements. So before we wrap up, just a quick announcement. First of all, a lot of the topics we've been discussing today have been kind of challenging. Channeling Victor Senger, who you also mentioned, the book, the God the Failed Hypothesis, is one of his masterpieces. So highly recommend that one. To know more about, like, specifically from physics and science based arguments. So the Secular Society of MIT, we meet on Tuesdays 5 to 6 p.m. in the Student Center, fourth floor. We have snacks, we discuss stuff every week, except tomorrow. Tomorrow there's a storm warning. So yeah, tomorrow's is cancelled, but next week, we're actually going to discuss today's topics tomorrow, but we're actually going to discuss it next Tuesday. And we also have brown bag lunches on the last Thursday of every full month of the semester. Coming up, we're having an event for people who are ex-believing Jews or Christians. This is part of our outreach to communities of people, you know, who are leaving specific religious communities because they all have different experiences and such. The venue is to be decided, but this will be in mid-April. Later this semester, we'll be having a film screening, and next semester we've got a great lineup as well. So there's going to be more Out and Outs, more Course Zero, Blasphemy Rights Day, and Sagan Day. Thank you all for attending. You can sign up for our newsletter. You can see us on Facebook. You can see us on Twitter. You can follow us on Twitter, Secular MIT. If you have a 21 plus age ID and some cash, you can join us after we wrap up at the Muddy Charles pub nearby. If you'd like to give feedback on this event, you can use this this short link, and just like let us know how you think it went. So thank you.